Дорогие друзья, рад приветствовать.
Dear friends, I'm glad to welcome everyone to the Гайда Forum. It's the second day of the forum. And today we are holding a session which I believe is unique. And I hope you'll treat it as such. You can see we have brought together three key persons who are responsible for the economic development in our country. The Minister of Finance, Minister of Economic Development, and Governor of the Central Bank. Thank you for joining us. If you'll allow me, I'll say some introductory remarks for a minute or two. Certainly, we're going to talk about economic growth and issues related with it. As we can see over the last decade, starting from the financial crisis of 2008 and 2009, we have been witnessing a strange, if not a unique, situation all across the world. And I would like to highlight that Russia, in that regard, is part of global processes. Of course, there are some specific features. Something is better, something is worse, but still, Russia makes an organic part of the global processes. And despite the pandemic, which can be even compared to a war, because there are many factors of non-financial nature, but still, just like that, just like the financial crisis, it triggered the need for structural reforms. And the financial crisis brought about a new model of economic growth. And right now, we also have a unique situation because the governments of advanced countries and developing countries, including Russia, they learned how to fight systemic structural crises. And we managed to prevent the Great Depression, the Great Stagflation, a new one. But at the same time, we brought to a minimum what Schumpeter called creative destruction. When we remember who went bankrupt, it was just Lehman Brothers, but it was that, just that. Everyone else was very fearful of repeating their history, and no one wanted to repeat the Great Depression with a 25% unemployment rate. But instead of that, even though we managed to learn how to fight crisis, structural crisis, we see a low level of investment, low growth level, and right now, the share of investment as compared to the GDP is lower than the share of saving because everyone is risk averse and doesn't want to take risks. So what are we to do? How do we get back to high rates of growth which we saw before 2008, 2009? And I'm talking not about a rebound, because a rebound is all but guaranteed after the pandemic, and there is no sense in talking about whether this is going to be a V-shaped rebound or a K-shaped rebound if we look at the history. So a rebound is certain to happen. But what comes next once the economy has recovered? We'll be able to hit high rates of growth, or maybe it is the new norm, the new normal. Do we have to admit that low growth rates are going to be a long-term part of our future, that we're going to green our economy instead of dollarizing it? Maybe we're going to address social issues without paying as much attention to growth issues. And the third scenario, maybe we are simply not assessing the growth rate correctly. Because, you know, digitalization has brought about immense changes. An e-book is less expensive than a paper book.
So,
if innovative goods are becoming cheaper very fast, it also is reflected in the statistics of the GDP. So, how do these two correlate, the GDP statistics and the welfare, the well-being statistics? We used to use GDP and GDP growth as a reflection of well-being growth. once, but maybe it's no longer the case. So these are the questions at hand we're about to talk about today, and I hope that we will do that. But before that, I would also like to say that we also have kind of a Russian part of this story, because even though Russia is part of the global economy, still there is some specific feature we have. Even though everyone likes to vilify Russia's economy, but still we have we are at advantageous situation because we have a very low level of public debt, which is mostly denominated in the national currency. We have a very low inflation, something to dream of. It's not less than 1%, something advanced economies are suffering of, but still it's not superior to 4%, well, if we round it up. So the inflation rate is within the target, and not everyone can boast the same results. So it's low, and yet it's controlled. We have a relatively low unemployment rate, even though it is superior to the one we saw back in 2019, but it's still within the norm for any developing economy. And to a large extent, unemployment rate growth is due to growing unemployment benefits. So it's statistical growth. People simply register more often as unemployed because of that. So how do we do that? How do we go forward and make our economy grow without destabilizing the macroeconomic fundamentals? Because for the last decades, we've been fighting macroeconomic issues like stability of the ruble, stability of the budget. We used to hit those targets, and then all of a sudden it all crumpled down, and we had to start from scratch. How do we save what we have right now, the accomplishments, while ensuring economic growth? I'm not going to go any further, because, as I said, we've got three wonderful speakers, three wonderful participants today on our panel. And my question is, of course, related to history, but still. During the Great Depression, it was important to ensure high growth rates. Amid the pandemic, however, and amid the financial crisis of 2008 and 2009, almost all developed countries sacrificed the economic growth for social and political stability back in the noughties and right now for the sake of protecting the lives of people. Does it mean that well-being and the quality of life emerge to the forefront? Do you see this conflict between growth rates and well-being, or growth as opposed to stability? Minister Siluanov, can we start with you? Yes, thank you very much, Mr. Mao. That is a very interesting way to put the question. I think there should be no opposition between well-being and growth. We should not put them as opposed to one another, because the goal of the government is to ensure the well-being of its citizens, raising their income, ensuring well-being, and economic growth is one of the greatest tools to do that, because if there is economic growth, then employment is going to be there, and budget revenues will be there, and they will get back to the citizens, and income is going to grow. So our end goal is to ensure well-being, but economic growth and ensuring economic growth are the tools to achieve that. What kind of growth do we need? You were right in your introductory remarks when you said that there are different types of growth. Sometimes you can ensure growth, which, however, does not result in this added value, that is, the well-being of citizens. The simplest example, you can dig a hole and then fill a hole. Everyone has been laboring, working arduously, getting the income, but there is no added value. This investment does not lead anywhere, as it were. Or several years ago, we saw some growth due to an increase in oil prices. Oil prices went up, there was growth, then they went down, and there was no growth. So the quality of economic growth is very important. It needs to create new economies, new industries. It has to sustain modern economy, providing new jobs, stimulating new technologies. That is the kind of growth we are in need of. And you're correct. Last year, just as other countries, we chose to sacrifice economic growth for the sake of lives of our citizens. We shut down whole companies. We announced a lockdown to protect the health and lives of our people. And it was the right thing to do. At the same time, we helped enterprises and businesses, the government, decided to lend them a helping hand, minimizing the negative consequences of the lockdown. We decided to help both citizens and business. And I think we did a good job. The borrowing did not grow that much. Our budget is not imbalanced. So these were targeted solutions, targeted measures that sought to support our business and our citizens. And this is what helped us weather this difficult period. Thank you very much. I would like to draw the attention of the audience to the fact that sometimes growth can be accelerated, but well-being can go down, like in the 80s. And macroeconomic fundamental was not that big. The budget deficit was growing, the public debt that was denominated in foreign currencies was growing. And we know the adverse example, like Japan, it's been stagnating for 25 years, but the well-being is going up and the standards of living are going up as well. So everything is relative. The important thing is the quality of this growth. Minister Reshetnikov, our Minister for Economic Development, what is your comment on that? What do you think? Good afternoon, colleagues. As a follow-up to what Minister Siluanov has said, I would like to point out that there is no opposition or controversy between growing wealth and growing economy. If we look at 2017, 2019, we see that the average growth rate of GDP was 2.2%. 1.9% was accounted for by the growing incomes of our population, and the end consumption of households over the 3 years and the GDP structure was growing at an average pace of 3.7%. Incidentally, it is vastly different from the growth rate of real disposable income, so it deserves a separate discussion. But without the growing consumption, without growing income of our population, it is going to be simply impossible to achieve the target growth rate of 3% for our GDP we want. Now, judging by the priorities of our current policies, as Minister Siluanov has pointed out, for the last year, our policies were focused on supporting our population through direct payments to unemployed citizens, to those who temporarily lost their jobs. We helped families with children, and we also supported business. And that was also meant to save jobs, and these programs are still very much ongoing. We've got a special program for writing off debt, and we are protecting more than 5 million jobs. Employers managed to retain these jobs, and we see that this program is highly functional. But the very structure of consumer expenditure can have an impact on economic development and economic growth. And as we can see, huge shifts are happening. Some are short-term due to the lockdown. Minister Siluanov has pointed that out as well. But there are some long-term trends we are witnessing, something we need to pay more attention to. I refer in particular to shifting preferences in trade. Whether people are getting back to malls, to offline platforms, are they going to get back to the cinema? What the service sector is going to look like? What about international tourism? Is it going to get back on track? We know that internal tourism can take up a an important share instead replacing international tourism? How many workers are going to stay on remote work? How is it going to impact the structure of business? How relevant are investments going to be? So we are still pondering on these issues, thinking how it's going to look like. And another important thing, well-being and wealth is not does not boil down to the income. It's also about infrastructure, the convenience of cities, bridging the digital divide, creating the opportunities for self-actualization. And this is yet another international trend we see emerging. We've got the SDGs adopted by the United Nations. We've got the OECD Index for Better Life. And we also have national development goals announced in June, the new edition of those. And they bring together the best practices. They take up the notion of economic growth and well-being. They make these indicators more comprehensive, painting a broader picture. And we know that to a large extent, economic growth is due to growing incomes. Thank you. Governor, what is your stance? Because just as in other developed countries, the central bank's role is very specific because everything comes down to you. Everything is up to you, too. And I will go as far as to say that if there was an economic growth miracle in Russia, then you are the ones responsible for that because you managed to bring inflation under control, thanks to what the central bank has done. So is it a step towards ensuring economic growth, or is it neutral as far as economic growth is concerned? I'll begin by saying that any economic policy pursues the goal of well-being, not low inflation or high growth rate. No, well-being and wealth, this is the end goal, and these are the notions we have to operate. I agree with Minister Siluanov. We have to define what kind of economic growth we want, because economic growth is a prerequisite, even though not the only one, for the growing well-being. We need to ensure that this well-being is constantly growing, that it is not just a short-term fling like that. And we also need to understand what well-being is about. It's not just about income, growing income. It's about how it's distributed, how the assets are growing, how new opportunities for further growth are emerging, and this needs to be thought about too. Of course, monetary policy is a contribution to well-being, because the population, the wide population, stands to benefit from a successful monetary policy because it creates investment and all that. It's not just that. And of course, low inflation is important too, because once inflation rate is going up, we understand how important it is to ensure the well-being of our people. But if one were to try to use monetary policy not just to ensure macroeconomic and financial stability, but also to ensure high rates of economic growth, well, that would be questionable. And the experience of developed countries is flagrant, glaring in that regard. You said it yourself. The policies were very soft, very loose, but the rates of growth were far lower than pre-crisis. But the income growth after the crisis of 2008-2009 was almost just like it was before. But how was it distributed? You know, if the monetary policy is not counter-cyclical, if monetary policy is used to boost economic growth, then we see that this moderate monetary policy either translates in high inflation or in more expensive assets. And who benefit from more expensive assets? Well, most certainly not the rank and file citizens, especially in countries where these assets are not distributed evenly. So inequality becomes a key factor for us to take into account to assess well-being. And the same goes for unemployment. We're accustomed to saying that we've got a relatively low level of unemployment. Other countries also use moderate monetary policy to keep unemployment rates in check. But look at the kind of jobs that were created. These jobs were not accompanied by greater productivity or greater income. So what we need is not just jobs, we need high quality jobs. They need to be highly productive that allow people to get more money. And in that sense, monetary policy cannot help, even though a lot depends on monetary policy indirectly, yes, the cost of borrowing, for instance, but mostly monetary policy is of a structural nature. And structural and other measures are needed to create a good investment climate, to ensure good education, mobility of labor force, to ensure creating competences. So this is an agenda we are supposed to pursue regardless of how we're going to overcome this crisis. These questions like fighting the pandemic, ensuring health, these issues are still there. They need to be addressed. These are key elements to ensure the well-being. If you'll allow me, of course, the monetary policy is an important regulatory instrument, and there is also regulatory instruments. The central bank has at its disposal, like the conditions for borrowing, the conditions for financial institutions. You can stimulate lending too. I would also like to point out that there is such a thing as unprofitable growth. So the growth can happen, but people are not content or happy about services, about their lives, and we don't need that kind of growth. What we need to do is to make sure that this growth translates in higher income and high quality of life and better life, to put it in simple terms. Yes, you know, we had a session about the notion of happiness. What is the answer, the key to that? Well, everyone has their own recipe for happiness. Yes, but there are things that are common for everyone. If you have no such things, you are simply not happy. Yes, and it also, of course, depends on your own perception, on the internal set of mind. This mindset has a huge influence on whether you think you are happy or not. Well, we can talk about happiness. Yes, but let's get back to economic notions, economic issues. Over the last decade,
you know,
We've been seeing what is dubbed unconventional monetary policy, an economic policy, the modern monetary policy, and of course, fiscal policy. Kendrogov, who participates in the forum, he says what is called a monetary policy is not modern, is not monetary, is not a policy. Let me explain. Sometimes there is a notion that you can print your national currency ad infinitum. You know, like they used to say before the Russian Revolution, there is this Freemasonry ruble, you can print it, you can spend it, and it will get back to you. And over the last two or three decades, we've been seeing this similar recipes crop up once again. Like you can print something, like money, and everyone is going to be happy, but it doesn't work that way. We see central banks increasing their balance sheets, public debt is soaring, but happiness is not there. It's as if we hit a new paradigm. And of course, it's all controversial. Some believe that it's all going to collapse, and it's going to collapse once everyone comes to believe that it's never going to collapse. It's about psychology, because 90% of economy can be explained through psychology. But still, however that may be, Madam Governor, to what extent do you think these arguments are sensible? Indeed, the leading banks like the Fed or the ECB are talking about new instruments, not just about QE. They talk about structural measures, taking into account climate-related factors when building their reserves and all that. What about the Russian Central Bank? I know that you analyze all these issues, but what about this shift? Do you think you're going to join the fold, or are we still in the field of tradition? Yes, we are more traditional, something we are often criticized for. We often hear recommendations to pursue unconventional policies and like quantitative easing, and there is unconventional fiscal policy when you build up your public debt ad infinitum because you can simply refinance it, as they said in the mid-20th century. The government can allow itself, can afford to go into the financial abyss indefinitely. Yes, but we are very cautious about that. We know that there are some limits to such unconventional fiscal policy of building up your public debt. And I believe that countries that pursue these policies, they are testing new ground. They're treading into new waters. They see that they build up public debt, but the servicing is not that expensive, and they make the next step. But as far as Russia is concerned, I think that would be a misadventure. Maybe this is going to be a misadventure for the whole world because no one knows the long-term consequences and where it will lead us to. But what we understand is that this policy will be very hard to abandon. Those countries that set the goal, they cannot do that because there is the fiscal domination and other issues that crop up. It seems that however much you funnel money into the economy, however moderate your policy is, the servicing is not that expensive, nothing collapses. But in case of Russia, this will not do because we are more vulnerable to external shocks. We are not in possession of a reserve currency, something Minister Siluanov and I say on multiple occasions. And moreover, this unconventional policy is fraught with risks. What are the benefits of such policies? We said that at the very beginning. Despite these policies are unable to ensure high growth rates, as we can see on others' example. Instead, it simply led to bigger bubbles, and no one knows how to remove these bubbles in an orderly fashion. Added to that, we see indicators of growing inflation in those countries. After the crisis, when moderate monetary policy was resorted to not as a counter-cyclical function, we knew it did not translate into assets or borrowing, and consumption was not growing at a high pace, and the money supply was not growing that fast. But right now, we see that inflation is speeding up, and many experts draw our attention to that fact. But I would like not just to dwell on that. I would like to mention the limits of unconventional fiscal policy. But there are also limits to conventional fiscal policy. Because when we talk about the efficiency, we need to distinguish between counter-cyclical policy, which needs to smoothen things up, and the policy that seeks to make our potential grow. Monetary policy, fiscal policy can have a counter-cyclical effect.
And definitely, what impacts the potential would be the fiscal policy that can determine the level of budget intervention and the priorities of the federal budget, and the structural policies also are an aid in this respect. But we should also be able to pursue counter-cyclical policies. Amid this pandemic, which was quite curious, we, the central bank, for the first time reduced the policy rate, so it was counter-cyclical, and the finance ministry spent a lot of the savings means thereof. And this room for counter-cyclical policies, we haven't exhausted that altogether, and we can respond if things deteriorate. We still have some room to respond, but we should probably come back to normal, to the neutral monetary policies, because crises happen all of a sudden, unexpectedly, and you should always have some room for maneuvering, some leeway. You should not be drawn into the corner. I will just allow myself a short personal comment. There are two more factors to take into account. For the first of all, this deflation specter starts haunting us. And analysts late last year, including The Economist, started writing about a possible deflation. You probably may not remember that. That term appeared in the 1970s, and to get out of it was quite hard and difficult. Populists here advocate for relaxed policies, but it is a source of growth and of inequality, as the previous decade has shown. Inequality doesn't mean that we have the stratification between the rich and the poor. No, it's the assets inflation. The owners of the assets become much richer against those who get a salary from their employer. And we should not be oblivious of that. Lenient and lax monetary policies would entail the rise in bad inequality. Yes, it's kind of bad inequality, improper. It's not that you work more and you earn more. No, just historically they may have more assets at hand. Mr. Siluanov, what is your view? We concur with Governor Nabiullina. We stick to the conventional and prudent rules in our action. I think it is a good thing. And last year, definitely, we had to act in a laxer way that was justified fully. I agree with Madam Nabiullina that we cannot continue that for good. And by 2022, we have a goal to come back to the normal fiscal and monetary policies. Indeed, last year showed that many countries had a frivolous attitude towards conventional instruments. They increased their debt burden up to 100% of GDP, which is unparalleled, unseen, a whopping amount. And the debts went up as well as the budget deficits, and they will be at bay. It will be hard for them to get out of that. They'll have to raise taxes or reduce budget spending. Will be a hard thing to do. They think that they can increase that debt, build that up, and the central bank would buy all of that. But it is possible unless there is inflation. And, you know, in case there is inflation, it won't work. All right, and I fully agree. And another point to make is that the injection of lots of money into the economy, huge debts piling up, and corporate debt increasing would have an impact, and someone has to pay. It's going to be grassroots, common people who will pay. At the end of the day, it will either entail high rates of inflation or the governmental spending will have to go down, and the quality of services, public services, definitely would deteriorate. You know, you always have to pay in the economy. There are always after effects of what you do. If you allocate money, if you drop the rates, you'll have to pay later. Advanced economies that have the reserve currencies are less susceptible to ups and downs and vicissitudes than the emerging markets, including the Russian Federation. And we faced similar things several times in the past, during the default times, for example, when we issued lots of bonds and were not able to service that debt. And it seemed back then that we would return to growth and we would receive more revenues and we will repay. No, nothing of the kind. We will have to pay. But, you know, the jurisdictions that issue reserve currencies, they have softer cycles, and for us we have much faster and sharper cycles, I mean the emerging economies like Russia. And the Russian Federation has outlined plans to normalize the fiscal policies, which I'm in charge of, and have carried out fiscal structural changes. As in your introduction, you have said that such a crisis always not just to reform some things that weren't reforming, that won't change. We have had a taxation maneuver. We have reduced taxation for small companies and IT enterprises, and we increased the tax burden for the oil and gas companies, which was a right thing to do. In procurement, we had some amendments. We have repealed some of the regulatory acts that were an impediment to business development, and we have altered our spending structure. Now we provide more help in a targeted manner to those that are in need of help and governmental assistance and financial backing from the state. And these changes must be pursued at difficult and hard periods. We just had to, it was a necessity. Just coming back to your question, I must say, well, you asked what follows a lax period. Returning to normality follows, and we will do that. In other countries, they will have problems, they will have issues doing that, and as far as I know, my opposite numbers don't think much about that, which definitely perplexes us, because we depend on what is happening worldwide, and at the G20 level and other levels, we keep urging our colleagues to normalize their policies. Just a quick comment, quick word. I fully agree that the price you have to pay for the financial bubbles will be high. But what is a bubble? It is when the productive and non-productive assets price or rates are assessed equally, and the creative destruction would not happen, which means that we would pay by the low labor productivity. This is why we have the low growth rates worldwide. Yes, and I want to yield to Mr. Reshetnikov and touch upon a very important issue related to the structural problems, not macroeconomic ones. We have a national plan, a blueprint that the government has endorsed. We also have programs to develop some of the sectors. And there, the budget investments, fiscal investments, will have the key role to play. They incentivize economic activities, but critics say that too much of attention is paid, too much of focus is put on the fiscal investments, and one should incentivize the private sector more, which is definitely a hard balance to strike, which is your responsibility, Minister Reshetnikov. Thank you for this clue, but as a follow-up to what has been said by Madam Nabiullina, that you cannot pursue lax monetary policy forever without inflation. I'll just cite a couple of figures. Over the past month, 10th of January, 10th to December, wheat prices globally increased by 10%. And it is a 30% rise versus October. So this is what we see from the contracted price of our exporters. So the main goal of the government now is to preclude the import of that food items inflation back towards our domestic markets. And we will definitely raise the export duties probably it is contemplated by the government. I think that we are now seeing the first sprouts that the global inflation is on the rise. If you look at commodities and capital markets, you will see that over the past months, all the prices, all the indices and rates go up, have been going up. Back then, we thought that lax policies would not entail inflation because there was no demand, probably. But now, with rebounding economies, we will see the speed up of inflation globally, which will be a major challenge, global challenge, and we are now bracing ourselves for that. As regards investments, 2.2% is the GDP growth over 3 years. 1% is derived from investments. 1.9% reduction was from the slump in the households consumption, but still we are on the positive territory in the black. And last year we had a 13% growth of fiscal investments, public investments, which was part of our counter-cyclic policy pursued by the government. It's a good thing that we stepped up fiscal and budget investments, not only the payouts, because we have been able to support demand in a number of sectors like the machine engineering and construction sector. At the same time, everybody asks what is next. We will have to consolidate the budget, it's inevitable, and a new wave of private investment growth will have to be initiated. In the past year, we did a lot to this end, like we enacted capital investment protection promotion legislation, which is a joint design project of the finance minister and the economic development minister, with the grandfather clause now being put in place, and now you can finance the necessary infrastructure and get the further taxes credited and offset. And apart from that, we laid the foundation last year with the housing bonds and infrastructural bonds, and we subscribed a governmental decree on 31st of December on that matter, and the green bonds are in the pipeline. So we work hard, and the finance minister and the central bank did a lot to invest, to help people invest at the stock market in shares and in bonds, putting up money there. The individual investors' accounts number doubled over the past year, and now have draft law that would allow to step up this type of activity, because the deposits appeal has fallen with the rates reduced, and new areas and territories and grounds for investments are needed. So we are coming up with new projects, with new offerings. It's not reassessing the existing assets, it's creating new assets. We have lots of projects, and the project's quality is differentiated. We have the conventional energy sector at stock, and petrochemicals, gas chemicals, developing fields and mines, and logistics and tourism on the agenda, with great added value. As regards other tools and instruments, I would single out the reform of the development institutions, as the development institutions aim to attract public, private investments to the public projects. Together with the school education ministry last year, we worked hard to unveil a mechanism that would expedite the construction of schools, because now we will organize concessions and the public-private partnerships, attracting private investors there. Per one fiscal ruble, would be able to raise up to 10 private rubles. And definitely we should be using this leverage, and we will be doing that. Well, the bottom line is that we used that past year to present new investment opportunities. It's too early to say that we launched a new investment cycle. No, but we have been laying foundation for that. And we are conducting structural changes in the taxation system and the small and medium enterprise support and supporting the IT sector, and the regulatory guillotine was put in place seeking to raise the labor productivity, and many other steps made are structural in nature. And I fully agree with Governor Nabiullina, without the growth of productivity, investment efficiency will suffer and will not have better living standards, and the incomes will not grow. Just yes, thank you. Just a short yes or no question, a quick one. We know that the central bank is the lender of last resort, but over the past couple of years, I see more and more talks to the effect that the government, the state, may be not only the lender but also the investor and the insurer of last instance or resort. So it's not actually a yes or no question, but is it fraught with risks, or is the upside prevailing? Well, I would answer in the positive way, but we should be quite prudent. I agree with Madam Nabiullina. So, Minister Reshetnikov, the government, should it be the last resort investor, the last instance investor? Well, either the government or the central bank. No, I mean just the budget. It's not about the central bank. The budget, yes, I think so. The central bank should not be such an investor, with many, many reservations, as we know that sometimes the public programs may be efficient. In other cases, they may not prove their worth and turn positive. No, we should not switch to the paradigm of central bank starting to invest something. No, it is the state, which is the government, not the central bank. A quick word on the public investments. When you asked Governor Nabiullina whether the central bank can act as such an institution, you know, we could have bonds, and some of the companies provide collateral. But Madam Nabiullina used to be the economic development minister. But speaking about the public investments, I must say I agree with you. At hard times, like what we had last year, the public investments should be on the rise, and they should be the catalyst and the enabler of the overall investment growth. But we should not overdo, because we borrowed over liquidity that would otherwise have flown to the private economy, so we should not overkill in this sense. Should not overindulge in such ideas. We should not be in the way of private investors, I think. Shouldn't hassle them. We should give the operational, robust institutions a chance to invest in the economy. As Minister Reshetnikov said, per one fiscal ruble, we should have 3 or 10 private rubles attracted and raised. But stepping up debt and sweeping all the money from the market and investing it via the government would not be the right thing to do. And many people erroneously think that once we step up public spending, we will have good results. No, you should not do that permanently. Well, at hard times like last year, it is possible. But, you know, we need institutional changes, like the protection of property rights and the reform of the judicial system, and that will be quite hard to do. Like, stepping up investments would not mean allocating or disbursing money from the federal budget, which is a simple thing to do, but this is not what we need to have the high-quality economy growth. Thank you. We have 11 minutes left. Another short topic for us to discuss. On the 15th of January, 1 year ago, we had the new prime minister. So tonight we'll celebrate his 1 year in office. And the incumbent prime minister was always known for using the digitalization efficiently, though he later had to combat and handle the pandemic. So we ended up in warfare all of a sudden. But anyway, the digitalization has become a very important factor. And for me, the outcome of the past year was the reconsideration of digitalization from a sector into a concept and a philosophy of the public administration, a new style of living encompassing and embracing macroeconomy, social aspects, welfare, anything. I want to ask our colleagues to provide their perspective on digitalization, and not in the sense that you think that something must be digitalized, but rather your vision of what the priorities of digitalization should be in future, like the central bank and going digital. Well, digitalization is not only a means of public administration, it's an all-pervading trait that will permeate our lives, impacting anything, including the financial sector, although our financial sector is quite advanced against other sectors of the Russian economy, as well as if we benchmark it against financial sectors of other countries. But that wouldn't mean that the financial sector has exhausted its growth in terms of digitalization. We see several key global trends in the advent of new technologies, and digitalization can hardly be regarded separately from other things, and the financial sector would build models on monetizing and commercializing big data using platform solutions and ecosystems that will bring about the emergence of new players from the non-regulated sectors inter alia. The competitive environment would change. For example, globally, internationally, the big techs would become part of the financial sector. They render non-financial services to our people. But what if they step in the financial market? That will have a brand new impact. What will that change? We're not sure what will work and what will not work, and we have to be agile and flexible. The regulation and legal systems of ours are not yet ready, unfortunately, to respond in an agile way to digitalization and to the new things emerging. In just a couple of words, our key goals for the future: we should be able to learn to regulate ecosystems. So far, we're not good at that. Now we're seeing the world that is ecosystem tolerant, and legislation emerges in China and in the EU. Personal data protection is part of that, the data inside and outside the ecosystem, and non-discriminatory access and competition protection. If you have one ecosystem and you can supply your products via this ecosystem, if you are disconnected, your business would be ruined, or if you are a consumer of services or goods that are sold via one sole ecosystem that is disconnected, you will not get your orders. And the third thing is something peculiar for this country: when an ecosystem is shaped around a major bank, which is a special challenge, a separate challenge to us. And then comes the digital ruble, which is a pillar of the financial digital infrastructure. We should modernize and retrofit our financial system, so we should be up to date in this respect. Minister Reshetnikov, your comment? I fully agree with those who compare digitalization with the overall electric supply in the 20th century. The scale of change in the economic structure is commensurate. Probably it's like the printing press that upended, uprooted all our lifestyles. Yeah, probably you are right. It is even more crucial and dramatic, and the pace is whopping and dazzling, and we are moving at a higher pace than one century ago. And we can see several things. First of all, it influences the investments in terms of structure and the proportions. ICT investments increased twofold over 6 years, which is a major shift. We're seeing an overhaul, an upheaval, and investments in fixed assets will go down, while the intangible assets will attract much more investments, and digitalization and platform emergence will lead us towards a sharing economy with one and the same input or means of production used by different actors, and the efficiency would go up on the one hand, but on the other hand that would reduce the need for investments because the economy would be able to grow at lower levels of investment with the help of the new sharing mechanisms and frameworks. And we are yet to become aware of that. And entrepreneurial practices are now being altered, diluted, the borders are shifted. It's like the Schumpeter-like entrepreneurship. And in this respect, we are in the vanguard, we are ahead of the curve, and our self-employed legislation and the professional income tax are novelties, and now we are seeing that we get many more people enrolling and much more revenue flowing in, opting for new forms of this hybrid model, and I think that these shifts are of importance. And responding to what Madam Nabiullina has said and following up on that, I must say that we see more and more interest from the business community to provide regulation for the ecosystems. In the past, we had to regulate relations and ties between producers and retailer networks and chains. And now we have to tackle in a prudent and careful manner the new things. Just in a nutshell, I'll tell you that the law on experimental pilot digital treatments will be soon submitted to the State Duma, which will be a major step forward. The electronic archives draft law is now prepared. It is now considered by the agencies and ministries, and the tax service has lots of proposals to shift to the document e-flow, and this country is among the leaders in the digital novelties, and we will be ahead of the curve, we'll be in the vanguard globally and worldwide, and we will step up the growth of our economy and labor productivity. Thank you.
Minister Siluanov, yes, just to sum up very briefly, well-being and growth are equal to institutional reforms we need and the all-nation digitalization by electrification plan. Yes, thank you very much. Precisely that. I'm very grateful to the participants of our today's discussion. I would like to say that we're going to have another session today, which is going to be moderated by Maksim Reshkin. It's going to be attended by Anastasia Rakova and Daniel Yegorov. is going to be dedicated to digitalization. Really, digitalization can allow a very deep transformation, turning government into service. Some time ago, President Vladimir Putin, when asked about what is the profession, was he said providing services to the population. So not just the president, but the government should provide services to the population. Turning the government machine into a service providing machine is the overarching goal. Colleagues, I would like to thank you, not just for the discussion, but for what you are doing to ensure stability and growth in our country. Thank you very much for your invitation.